delicate to look at, bonds with emotion, handles every situation with ease as goes the notion. Takes birth as a daughter, simple but energetic, becomes quickly someone's sweetheart, attractive and magnetic. She is the daughter, she is the sister, she is the mother, she is the nature. With this, I wish you all a very happy Women's Day. A very good evening, one and all. The galaxy of intellectuals, esteemed scholars, invited guests, teachers, and my dear friends. I am Ms. Jishma S. Nair, lecturer cum research scholar, Arunachal University of Studies, as the moderator of today's program. I bid a very warm welcome to all the renowned guests, speakers, and delegates who took out their valuable time and joined us today to be a part of this webinar. We are honored to have you all with us for the launch of Dr. Nandini Vashishta's edited book, Women's Rights and Justice, Theory and Praxis. With that note, let me introduce and welcome Dr. Nandini Vashishta, Executive Director, Indian Institute of Human Security and Governance, India, and Assistant Professor, Amity Institute of Liberal Arts, Amity University, Mumbai, India. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Jishma. I welcome you all to this unconventional book launch. Like new normal situation, this is also a new style of launching book. You know, movie ke pehle trailer dikhate hai to promote. This book launch webinar is like a trailer. All authors, including me, will let you know what you will get inside the book. If you search in internet, you will find numerous books on women's rights and justice. Then why this book again with the same tag? Actually, in this book, we have tried to depict recent issues and trends, including pandemic situation. In 26 essays, erudite scholars tried to explore situation of women in India, Bangladesh, and Russia in several domains, including the rights of women in India, legal framework, real situation, change in time of COVID-19 pandemic period, their manifestation in public policies, domestic arena, literature, and other spheres. Now, rights and justice, both are very vague terms. We change according to time and place. Right exercise of rights depends upon the beholder, or in other words, the perception of rights is subjective. Although all human beings exercise equal, quote unquote, equal rights according to the laws of most of the countries of the world, but in practical level, it varies according to time, area, and status, and obviously gender. In a social milieu, a woman's mind nurtured such a way that sometimes it even can't recognize the fact that her rights are encroached and she is enduring injustice. That's why when an intelligent girl child barred from higher education and forced to get married, she most of the time do not understand that she also has right to education. Most of the time, a woman count everyday domestic violence as quote unquote natural in a family. Even molestation, she tolerates, and at times they doesn't report any legal case to protect her prestige. So, in a nutshell, one can say what we see in theory as rights and justice is not applicable in praxis or reality. This debate is the main crux of the book. If we talk in Indian context, then women have many rights and many laws for securing justice of women, both as community and as an individual. If we see deeper, we have only lovely acts, but facts are scary. Here, patriarchy prevails in both state and society. Patriarchal norms treat women as the sexual property of men, as objects rather than subjects, as goods to be exchanged, ignored, or belittled, or as disposable beings who may be abused or even killed. India has a long history of women's movement or women's activism, but most of the time, women fought for their rights and justice either individually or community-wise. No single united women's movement happens in India. In this book, we will try to analyze how rights and justice of women are conceptualized and their practicality. This book contains that this is indeed a paradox in which women's human rights and feminism are caught today. At stake, therefore, is our capability of lifting our humanity beyond the self, beyond one's own culture, and particularly to reach out and ease the other, transcending social, economic, and ideological divide. It is quite obvious fact that rights and justice of women cannot be ensured without full cooperation of men and women, state and society, family and individual, and therefore, we must all work in unison. The authors in this volume present an impressive array of intellectual insights into the various aspects of women's empowerment, rights, and justice. Taken together, we bring clearly before you the whole array of challenges that confront India, Bangladesh, Russia today. I hope it will appeal to public policy analysts and feminist scholars who have yet to adopt the contribution of critical development studies in the analysis of different dimensions of female rights and liberties. I am now stopping here. That's all I want to say about the book. I must thank Mittal ji for wonderfully designing the book. You can see this is the book. I also want to thank all the contributors who wrote beautiful papers and submitted in time. And I also thank all the readers who is willing to buy and read our book. That's all. Now over to you, Jisma.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Without any further delay, I would like to call upon Dr. Rani Jha, a well-known scientist by profession, is a synthetic organic chemist who has been working in the field of green sustainable chemical technologies, agrochemicals, drug development, global climate change, carbon capture, polymer chemistry, and nanotechnology. She has a research experience associated to University of Mumbai, University of Vermont, USA, and Georgia Institute of Technology, Atlanta, Georgia. She is currently the Director of Science and Technology in Arunachal University of Studies, Arunachal Pradesh. I welcome you, ma'am, please.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. You are.
Thank you all. First of all, a very good evening to everyone. And I would wish you all a very happy International Women's Day. To begin, I would like to thank Dr. Nandini Basisht, editor of the book Women's Rights and Justice, Theory and Praxis, for inviting me to be a speaker on the occasion of this book launch event. Ma'am, I'm delighted to be a part of this event. Today, as we are celebrating International Women's Day, which is globally celebrated to mark the social, economic, cultural, and political achievements of women, women's rights, which is undoubtedly a debatable subject for centuries, is yet to be fully achieved. It is surprising to see both men and women getting confused about the topic of women's rights, some easily mixing it with extreme feminism. Today, I would like to reiterate that feminism or women's rights to equality is not a fight against men. Women does not want or wish for the rights to be taken away or rule over men. Men have always been an unconditional support system for women, be it at home or at workplace, as a father, a brother, a friend, a colleague, or a partner. But somewhere the dominancy, what we call in as the patriarchal society, has diminished the role of women in the society. Women of today's world is often judged in anything and everything they do, they are not being compared to their men counterparts in a healthy manner. This is what we all need to stand up for and bring a change in. The women in different parts of the world have varied rights and freedom. Even in India, in various parts, we have differently, totally, entirely different view of what rights of women means. Though I have traveled almost in all the parts of India, I would like to speak a bit about the Northeast India, which is my current location of stay. In here, women, like other parts of India, have the major responsibility of managing household activities, including taking care of children, like others. But comparably, they enjoy more freedom than some other parts of the nation. Tribal population, which is what dominated in the entire Northeast region of India, is mostly populated in this region. In tribal culture, a woman gets the right to choose her education and also her partner, which is very common in here, but very uncommon in other parts of the nation. Women are actively involved in politics, and that involvement is growing every day in all states of Northeast. A true empowerment is visible in this part of the country. Men are very supportive to all the women folks of their family. So rights are efficiently blended with the justice one must get. On this line, self-help groups, which is existing in this part of the country, commonly known as SHGs, are spread all across the northeastern states, which is formed with the women of the bastis, or what we call the villages. They are in constant touch with other women of the location. This group assists women folks in solving trivial home issues, understand monetary management systems and schemes. They also are a link between the government and locals in implementing the various governmental schemes or developmental schemes brought in from time to time. What's important here to understand is that until one acknowledges the rights that one should get, one would not know when to stand up to get justice or what is wrong. Justice is a fight to achieve the rights that one does not get by culture or the character. With all the empowerment in the nation, including the Northeast, domestic violence terminology is not fully understood. Mental torture or ill treatment by a partner is excused in the name of adjustment. Educating the women folks around us is therefore all the very important in differentiating the sense of adjustment to make things work, and taking uncalled acts upon themselves is the most important thing and is very much needed. This day, with a dual celebration, one celebrating the International Women's Day, and second, the launch of an exceptionally well-compiled book by Dr. Nandini Vashisht, let us all pledge to do everything in our capacities to empower the women around us, for it is only with equal contribution from all genders that we will be able to create a sustainable future for the planet. Let us all go with the theme for this year's celebration of International Women's Day, choose to challenge. Let us choose something good, something which would change the lives of all the women associated with us and around us. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Without consuming any time, now I would like to call upon Mr. Soham Samajpati. He's in the Department of General Medicine, Russian National Research Medical University, Moscow, Russia, and is economic implication and security concerns of women doctors amidst COVID-19 pandemic. Sir, please.
Good evening, everyone. And I am Soham Samajpati from the Department of General Medicine, Russian National Research Medical University, Moscow. This paper of mine, first of all, I wish everyone present here a very happy International Women's Day. And it was really interesting working with Dr. Nandini Vashisht and writing a paper which focuses on the implications of economic implications, the portion of medical science, and gender rights as concerned. So this paper of mine has been jointly written by me and my dear colleague, Mr. Somrat Ray. He is completing his doctorate in economics from Peter the Great, St. Petersburg Polytechnic University. So actually, I am involved in various types of researches related to virology of COVID-19, and also I'm involved with COVID-19 combating technologies, R&Ds of it. So me and Dr. Shamrat, Mr. Shamrat, we came up upon a plan, and along with Dr. Vashishta, and we thought on how about we write about the social implications of COVID-19, because it is no more a virus of just pathological and medical importance. It has become part of a hindrance of livelihood of each and every people living here. So we basically based our work on the conditions of doctors, especially and nurses, especially the female doctors and nurses, their problems they are facing with their works, and actually there is like, as an author, I would say that there has been given immense focus on from the aspect of virology, from the aspect of chemistry of the virus, from the aspect of economical implications, and obviously the gender problems which are cropping up due to this virus. We have used statistical data as available on infections, cross-hospital infections, and how infections are affecting doctors and medical workers, and how especially female medical workers, because anatomically and physiologically, there are few technical problems to which female medical workers are more exposed. So we have compiled data and written a chapter on that. And I would really wish if this book, this chapter of mine reach out to the mass as a whole. And I guarantee that people from any field, technical or non-technical background, would like the writing we have presented. What we have done specially is we have chalked out a scheme of reducing, and I know it might be technically very not so plausible to absolutely reduce these infection problems to 0%, but we can reduce it to a high extent. We have recommended the system which was used in during the days of formation of Soviet Union, which is called the Semashko model. Semashko model is basically compartmentalization of hospitals and dividing into it in various departments with various sterilization units so that infection is less. That's the one point. And second point we have based on, we have compiled it on how in working place, in a clinical setup, doctors, nurses, and with an emphasis on female doctors as obviously, how they're facing trouble or problems from miscreants, and how these things are becoming life-threatening at times, in not only in India, but in various place, parts of the world. So I would conclude by saying, I won't explain my work. I would request the readers to go and read my chapter and a chapter of other authors as well. And I think that the undergoing medical graduates, nurses, doctors would really relate to the problems about which I and Dr. Mr. Ray have talked. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable words. Now, next I call upon Diksha Nargotra, research scholar, Department of Sociology, Jammu University, Jammu, India. And her contribution for the book is on the role of government in reference to welfare of women with disabilities. Ma'am, please.
A very good evening to all of you. Firstly, a very special day today, not just only for us, but for every female in every corner of the world. So very happy International Women's Day to all the girls, women, and even all the males of the world. So very happy International Women's Day to all of you. I would like to thank Dr. Nandini Bashisht, ma'am, for giving me the opportunity to give my contribution for this book. I have worked a lot on persons with disabilities. I love to interact or write papers and articles for persons with the special needs. I would not say I have worked so much on disabled people, so I would not use the term disabled, as it is not the right word. I would use that they are the persons with special needs. So my contribution for this book was the welfare of the disabled women, the specially abled woman, I would say, instead of disabled, I would use the term the specially abled. So it is the welfare of the specially abled woman, especially in the reference of the government and as well as both the non-government organizations. What role both government and non-government organizations have done for the welfare of the specially abled woman. As we all know that disability as a global concern has acquired the minds of both government and even the non-government organizations. And if we look at the census of 2011, we all know that the persons with disabilities, they have increased from 22 million in 2001 to 26.8 million in 2011. So this chapter basically discusses the various landmarks achieved by the central government, various acts, policies, schemes for the persons with the special needs. So if I talk about the present bill, which talks about the specially abled persons, that is the Right of Persons Disability Act Bill, the 2016 bill, it has replaced the previous bill, which was the 1995 bill. In this bill, we have 21 types of disabilities. So basically, we are focusing, earlier there was just 5 types, now we have the 21 types of disabilities, and it is more accessible. This bill has made India more accessible to persons with disabilities. But personally, I would say not just in making schemes, acts and policies, accessibility needs to be at the ground level. There is lack of accessibility at the ground level till date also. I do not know, but personally, my university lacks accessibility. There is just one ramp constructed for persons with special needs, but I do not know even if they can walk on that ramp because it is too slippery. So if you are making any policy, act or anything for persons with disabilities, please at least make sure you are just focusing on their needs as well. So while talking about the various acts related to disability, there are 5 major acts which talks about disabilities. One is the Rehabilitation Council of India Act. Then there is Persons with Disabilities Act. Then we have the Mental Health Act, the National Trust Act, then the Persons Rights of Persons with Disabilities Bill 2016, and various acts. All these acts and schemes, they have various role to play for the persons with special needs. We have the grievance redressal program in this, we have training programs, we have the social securities, we have the affirmative action programs for them. Then we have education, we have 4, now we have from 3 to, we have 4% reservation for them in various government jobs. And as I previously told you that the 2016 bill, it is talking about that the types of disabilities have increased to 21 disabilities. Now, even the acid attack victims also come under this this bill. They are also considered as disabled. And other concessions and schemes, as we all know, there are concessions in railways, airways, there is conveyance allowance, postage, and there are other allowances as well. There is income tax allowances, there are child care allowances, but that is up to 2 children only. So I would personally, I would like to say that the Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities has has made the Accessible India campaign for everybody. And for that, we also celebrate the International World for Disabled. That is on 3rd, every year on 3rd December. But we should also make sure that there are people, persons who are also on the forefront. We always see disabled as activists, but how many of us have actually seen persons with disabilities when you visit the restaurants, shopping malls, or XYZ places? So they should be actually at the ground level also. So what we all need to do is we need to change our minds. And especially on this Women's Day, I would like to request you all, please change the stereotypes, change your minds regarding persons with disabilities. They are different. But do not treat them as unequal. They are different. Give them some time, but give them equal opportunities to participate in everyday life. Thank you so much. Thank you, Nandini, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Next, I would like to call upon Dr. Sujit Kumar Datta. He is an associate professor, Department of International Relations, University of Chittagong, Bangladesh. His contribution is on women empowerment and sustainable development in Bangladesh, a post-COVID assessment. Sir, please.
Very good evening and happy Women's Day to all. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Thank you. And thanks to the organizer for inviting me to present my chapter on this book launch program on women's right and justice, theory and praxis. Special thanks to the special guest, Dr. Ranija, for her informative, outstanding speech. Finally, thanks to Dr. Nandini, editor of this book, for inviting me to be part of this academic work. My chapter title is Women Empowerment and Sustainable Development in Bangladesh, a Post-COVID Assessment. And me, Dr. Sujit Kumar Dutta, Associate Professor, Department of International Relations, University of Chittagong, Bangladesh. And this chapter argues for a broader emphasis on women empowerment to ensure sustainable development goals in Bangladesh in the post-COVID-19 pandemic. Women's empowerment and sustainable development is an essential topic in the national and international context. In a male-dominant society, it is thought that there is no need for women's view on family, socioeconomic, and political issues. Due to various social neglects, women's political and economic rights have not been yet established in the desired way. In the context of Bangladesh, it will be possible to achieve the Vision 2021 and the Sustainable Development Goals, SDG 2030, by eliminating gender inequality and empowering women. There is no alternative to women's empowerment to ensure sustainable development. It is noted that all the countries in the world where, especially New Zealand, Singapore, Finland, Barbados, Taiwan, and Bangladesh have shown comparative efficiency in the preventing the ongoing global pandemic, women have the responsibility of the head of the state or head of the government. Bangladesh has made remarkable progress in women's empowerment in different sectors. Soon after independence, the father of the nation, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, put women at the center of the country's development agenda. Under Bangabandhu's undisputed leadership, a constitution based on equal rights for men and women in Bangladesh was ensured. The government of Bangladesh has formulated a progressive women development policy in 2011. The reserved seats in Parliament of Bangladesh have been increased from 45 to 50. The current parliaments consist of women of the leader of the house, the deputy leader of the house, the leader of the opposition, and the speaker. Besides, 30% of the seats of local government system is reserved for women. On the other hand, special provisions have been made to increase women representations in public meetings. Bangladeshi women have now become high court judges, secretaries, public universities, vice chancellors, and much more. Bangladesh currently employs 20 million women in the agro industry and service sector, and more than 3.5 million women in the ready-made garments sector, which is one of our most vast export earning sector in the economy. in my chapter research method. This paper has been prepared using secondary data, data from books, government reports, journal articles, newspaper articles, and web-based information on the sustainable development goals have been given priority as a secondary data. The document study method has been used to conduct this research. Women empowerment in sustainable development goals. The fifth goal of the sustainable development goals is to focus on ensuring gender equality. Every goal of the SDGs is poverty alleviation, hunger eradication, health, quality education, clean water and sanitation, quality work for all, the innovation of industry and the construction of improvement infrastructure, responsible use of global resources, climate change, the prevention, sea protections are directly or indirectly related to each gender equality of the Partnership for Sustainable Development. That's why women empowerment and sustainable development are much more. The findings of my chapters. The first one, Bangladesh has made significant progress in sustainable development goals and the Global Economic Forum, moving ahead in the world ranking. Bangladesh ranks 50th and 91st in the Global Gender Gap Index and Global Wage Gap Index, respectively. Second, Bangladesh ranked 50th position at Global Wage Gap Index in 2020 report. According third one, according to the Global Gender Gap Report in 2020, the current participation rate of women in Bangladesh is about 38.1%, which was 34% in 2070 and 36.9% in 2019. So it's increasing gradually. Fourth one, Bangladesh has shown tremendous success in the education sector with gender parity in primary and secondary education. Women's literacy rate had been improved remarkably at 71.2% in 2020 from 31% in 2006 and 58% in 2015. So women in education is improving day by day. Bangladesh ranked 7th out of 153 countries in the Global Gender Gap Index report on 2020 for women political empowerment, which is the highest rank in the South Asian countries. So in the concluding part of my chapter, I want to discuss that the biggest pandemic since 1918 is now happening worldwide, like COVID-19. The whole world is in a state of shock. Business is almost closed. People are not leaving their homes if they don't want to go. There is no country in the world where the corona infection has not occurred. The lockdown is happening almost all over the world. In this situation, United Nations Secretary General said, quote, women worldwide have been victims of family violence, unquote. As a developing country, Bangladesh is working towards achieving sustainable development by eliminating gender inequality and women's empowerment. Without meaningful participation of women in the post-COVID-19 economic and industrial revolution, Bangladesh will not be able to achieve the desired success in the sustainable development goals by 2030. Women need to be given proper training in the use of information technology so that they don't face any danger in the use of ICT. Thank you very much. Thank you. Listen to me.
Thank you so much, sir. A very appraised contribution as well. Now, I would like to welcome Soumen Bhattacharya, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Panchmura Mahavidyalaya, Bankura University, West Bengal. And the contribution is on women's rights and justice, Indian scenario. Please.
Good evening to all. Many thanks organizing Nandini Bagivi to at its beautiful event today. Also, many thanks to Mittal publishing the book so beautifully. The webinar is very much important for recent times, and today is also a very relevant day to discuss the webinar. Well, every society, women play very, and India is no exception. But what is ironic, quite her equal share, she remained at the mast in our part of the world. Very strong character than him, as the not only family, as a daughter, mother. India has always various cultures and various influx of people from. The society has remained in a constant change. The advent of the 15th century marked life and behavior of people changes in the Libya. The Indians undergone a drastic change, dedicated and cutted seven, and had limited the participant life. The Eastern.
Now, next, I would like to call upon Aman Sambyal. He is a student in the Department of Youth Services and Sports, Jammu and Kashmir, and his contribution of sports in women empowerment. Please kindly say a few words.
Good evening to all. I am Aman Sambyal, working in the Department of Youth Services and Sports as a physical education teacher. So I thank Nandini Madam to give me the opportunity to write a chapter related to women empowerment. And this chapter and my chapter is related to women and girl which take part in a sports. And the name of my chapter is Contribution of Sports in Women Empowerment. Women empowerment is the aptitude of women to practice full command over their activity. In current situation, games and sports and physical activity are significant for everybody. I suspect it is particularly critical for games and sports. Games and sports and physical activity is a passage for different opportunity as a technique for empowerment of girls and women. Games and sports and physical activity programs strengthening and creating a social development for women for their privilege. As we've seen that games and sports can decline, change existing sexual orientation standard and help girls and women move into public space. Empowering women through games and sports is an effect and exploitation distribution which center around the impact of games and sports program on the lives of women in different parts of the world. Empowering girls and women through games and sports. In the current scenario, games and sports and physical activity project can be the significant aptitude of social empowerment through the value learning. Fundamental ability preparing is generally given space to women to discover natural and where they have a sense of security, such as space and facilities inside their school, colleges, workplace, and sports related activity and the part of training time. Empowering female officials, as we know that strong female role model might be to remain positive, to ensure and take great considering of themselves. Female official, coach, trainer are vital to guarantee the accomplishment of games and sports. When girls seen these female officials as their role model, and in the form of their mentor, official coaches for their own fraternity. Then they take up administration position, the likelihood that they can accomplish similar achievement, becoming all more genuine. Emotional development among women. Safe space in such manner, physical security implies that games and sports program organize the necessary that girls are shielded from body harms as severe, including sexual abuse, drugs, infection, and sports injuries. Empowering economic empowerment. A wide range of opportunity for employment exists in the world of games and sports, as becoming a coach, a manager, sports administrator, trainer, game official, referees, physical education teacher, sports therapist, journalist, editor. Position also exists in the commercial sports industry, such as sports marketing and branding. The games and the sports and sports related organization to develop policy, program, and design structure that increase the number of women coach, advisor, official, administrator, decision maker, and sports personality at all level. Simply, the empowerment means moving from a weak position to become strong, more confident, and to overcome the sense of powerfulness. The topmost priority of women empowerment is to educate the woman, which is most dominant tool for altering the position of women in the society and the community. And at last, as we seen that few day back, international athletic player named Hima Das become a DSP in Assam Police. This is called a woman empowerment, and the government also initiate this type of program or this type of initiatives and to empower the woman. And that's all, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Nandini Vishisht, ma'am, for giving me the opportunity to write a chapter.
Very well,
on woman empowerment. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Next, it is my pleasure and very much honor to welcome our Professor Dr. Meghna Guha Thakurta, Department of International Relations, University of Dhaka, Bangladesh. Dr. Meghna Guha Thakurta taught international relations at the University of Dhaka, Bangladesh, from 1984 to 2006. She is currently Executive Director of Research Initiatives Bangladesh, a research support organized based in Dhaka, which specializes in participatory action research with marginalized communities. Dr. Guha Thakurta graduated from the University of Dhaka and received her PhD from the University of York, UK, in politics. Her field of specialization has broadly been international development, gender relations, and South Asian politics. She is well published in Migration Trends in Partition Histories, Peace Building in Post-Conflict Societies, and Minority Rights in South Asia. She is also Associate Editor of the Journal of Social Studies, published from the Center of Social Studies in Dhaka. Meghna ma'am was formerly member National Human Rights Commission, Bangladesh. She is currently advisor to the International Chittagong Hill Tracks Commission and has been project coordinator of RIB's project in the registered Rohingya refugee camps as implementing partner of United Nations Human Commission from 2011 to 2015. And currently leading two projects with host communities in Cox's Bazar. She co-edited the Bangladesh Reader and has several publications on the above issues in national and international journals. Anything less would be very much insignificant. So I would like to welcome our Honorable Dr. Meghna Guha Thakurta. Ma'am, please.
It's so apt that such a book is being launched today. I would first of all like to congratulate Dr. Nandini Vashishta, the editor of the book, as well as all the authors, some of whom have given their excellent presentations, given us an idea of what this book is about. So thank you very much, all of you, for your work. And I am indeed very, very, I wish I could have had the book now, but unfortunately, we're still not, the postal services are still not working. So, and it will be a little while till I can travel to India and I can get a book from there. So until then, thank you, Nandini, for sending me the pre-pages of the book so I could get an idea of what it is. As it is, I think the book is amazing because of two things. First of all, its title includes two things, two words, which are not often put together. One is justice and the other is praxis. Now, a lot of access to justice is a very common term in when we talk about women's rights and the gender equality or even inequality. So that is understandable. And mostly we derive this sense of justice from some norms. They are sometimes international norms, and sometimes they're contextualized in the nation state or in the region that we are concerned about. But to relate it with praxis is, I think, quite insightful. Praxis is not only about being about practical. It is not only practical things that we are doing or practice that we are talking about. Praxis is a term which has been used by different scholars in different ways, but I think most of all what endears me towards praxis is, of course, the element of experiential knowledge. So practice is not without knowledge. In order to practice something, you have to have knowledge and you have to have the experience. And that experience itself gives it knowledge. So it's quite a roundabout way of sort of a circular way of thinking of reasoning, of thinking of mental abilities. And I am at the Research Initiatives Bangladesh. We specialize with marginalized communities, and we have a specific usage of the tool of participatory action research, where we actually use praxis as one of the ways in which research or knowledge can be circulated from the grassroots up to the tertiary level and then back to the grassroots. So marginalized communities whom we work with, and they can be tribals, they can be indigenous communities, they can be minorities, disability, people with disabilities, amazing amount of work that has been covered in this particular anthology. So for us, praxis is a circular way of reflection, action, and reflection. So this is what I think relates to justice, because justice is not an ideal or a norm up there which we try to apply. We do that, but it's not a one-way street. So sense of justice or sense of the justice in the contextual way is related to people and people's way of thinking. So for example, we might have the concept of access to justice in terms of the United Nations, how it uses it, like in UNHDR, the Declaration of Human Rights. But at the same time, how is that contextualized in a country like Kashmir, in a region like Northeast India? This is what is very challenging, because the the once you start contextualizing idealistic norms, you find that people may think of it in a different way, may approach it in a different way, and perhaps if we relate to how they approach it, perhaps we can also make it more effective. And this is something that has endeared me towards the title of this book, Nandini. And thank you very much for bringing these two terms together so that we can actually think of it a little bit more. It gives a lot of food for thought. And it's great that you've done that. And I hope that, and I'm sure once I read the book and by the presentations that some of the authors have made today, I believe that they have played around with this concept in a very proactive way and have related it to their own context. So that brings me to the other interesting element of this book, which is very different from any other anthologies, I think. So India is, this book actually brings to light and foregrounds the fact that India is not a monolithic state, and definitely not a monolithic, no state I think is a monolithic state, not even Bangladesh, although it has a common language, but it has different cultures. So India has different cultures, diversities, of course we knew that, but the fact that each diversity brings up its own spaces of discourse, and the diversity is also at two layers. One is the diversity is, of course, a geographical diversity. We have papers here from Kashmir, a state you don't usually talk about in any Indian discourse, a nationalist discourse. On the other hand, you have the state of Mizo, and the northeast and the eastern part of India, which also gets sort of submerged under a lot of pro-North Indian based studies. So I'm so happy, Nandini, that you have been able to bring these unheard voices, whether they are of men or women, it does not matter. And you have brought in an extra gendered layer of these unheard voices. So it's difficult to hear voices from Kashmir. It is even more difficult to hear Kashmiri voices, and even more difficult to hear Kashmiri voices who are persons of disability. And so you have really brought in the layers of diversity that is a true representation of India. That is a true representation of Bangladesh as well, because what is happening in Chittagong is not happening in Dhaka, or what is happening in Dhaka does not necessarily happen in Jessore or Rajshahi. So thank you for that diversity, and also the fact that that this vast and varied anthology has brought in spaces where gendered inequality is less heard of or have explored new areas. I was quite entranced by the presentation on the medical aspects of care workers, and care workers being mostly women, and how the COVID and order has affected hospital systems, in turn affecting women care workers. And it is something that is not particular to COVID times. It is also something that is particular to any kind of care infrastructure, you could say. I've always said that pandemic has brought forth a kind of a rethinking and a revisitation of the care infrastructure. We moved away from the welfare state thinking that market is the thing to look upon now. Market is the hallmark or the indicator of a successful nation, how much we have entered the market, both national market as well as global market. But, and to the cost of not talking enough about care, about health, about education, the sectors which have been privatized so much that they have lost the sense of welfare or the sense of well-being, you could say, which is again coming up, you know, the element of staying safe in a country, in our country, an element of saying stay safe in these times has become important again. And when our dear and loved ones, we go into a hospital, what sort of care are they getting? So this is really a very, very, I would say, I don't know how you were able to do it in such a short time to bring in the COVID aspects, to bring in the medical aspects into this discourse, because surely you must have started this journey a long time ago when the COVID was not there. So so kudos to you to bring this all in into your discussion and making it much more a lively and at the present for a momentous kind of anthology as well. It's for it speaks of the moment. I was also very interested to hear about disability problems. We know that anytime we talk about differences, anytime we talk about inequalities, we tend to talk more about other inequalities, but disability always gets sidetracked. And it is something that relates a lot to this praxis element, because the only those who are disabled or specially enabled, interestingly enough, I think it was Deeksha who said that, our both the members of our mentors who set up our research organization also refused to call disability, term disability. We have a professor who was a very highly well-known economist, Professor Anisur Rahman, and he never talks about disability, about differently enabled. We said specially enabled, we said differently enabled, because we know that a blind person may not be able to see like me, but he or she may have other facilities and faculties which are much more powerful than what I have. So who is to learn from whom? You know, so it is a cross-learning thing. And I'm so glad that you brought it up in your presentation. Also, we see that sports is an amazing kind of, and it is going to be an issue for the future as well, because the physical things that we face in looking at differently enabled people, and the physical things we look at in terms of the medicals and the sickness and illness and wellness, all these are related also to sports. And it is very much true that in sports, we are revisiting and rediscovering women's voices in a new way. We all know that women are much more or less equal in sports, mostly because of the physical aspects and then in any other sectors. But do they enter sports when they do enter sports, what is it they engage with? What allows a woman entry into sports in a different way than a man who or a boy who enters into sports? Obviously, the first thing that a woman has to face in such a sector is her identity, is her traditional roles. Her role is a traditional, as a homemaker. How far is that from enabling to participate in the Olympics? Or for example, we've had our first, Bangladesh has had its first football internationally football coach, a woman from the Chakma community. She has first referee, and she has refereed the first international match a woman has refereed in Sri Lanka, football, sorry. So this is very interesting how spaces where women and men are, where there is more gender inequality, and maybe when they enter into a space which is not a very common thing for them to enter into. Maybe they are forced to rediscover a lot of things within oneself, which they then translate into their professions and to take up sports as a profession. So very, very interesting dynamics that you have set up. And thank you for all that discussion. BSTG was also, they ended up with the fact, there's an improved post-COVID times. Of course, we have a lot to think about SDGs because many of the indicators that were usually used for SDGs, like garments factory work, agriculture work, informal sector, are no longer there because of COVID, because of lockdown. So where do women take up from there? You mentioned information technology. That is another space which is where women have to struggle to get access to. And but once they do, it is absolutely just arena, truly arena where the less heard can be made much more vocal because of the medias, because of the technology that is being offered to us, for like Zoom. Those who have difficulty in traveling will be able to work with Zoom. So these are new things that we should embrace in our the course, and through embracing and engaging with these spheres which are less heard of. And that is what really enchants me about this book, that you are bringing to light what is possible, and to bring in this discussion about experiential knowledge. So someone may have theorized something in Paris or in New York, but we are living those realities, and the experiences that come from living those reality can enter into a larger and a much more meaningful conceptualization of what we mean about by justice and by praxis. I really again congratulate all the writers and the author and the editor for bringing out such a wonderful treat for those who work in this area. And I hope, as well as you know, critical reviews, because that helps you to grow. And this book is about growing, is about discovering, it's about exploring. And thank you for inviting me to comment on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you
Meghna, so much, ma'am.
Yeah, Zishma,
for your words of wisdom.
Before you invite the next speaker, I want to say something to Meghna Di.
Yes,
Zishma,
ma'am.
May I?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So, Meghna Di, thank you for wonderfully describing the words, the title of our book, as well as the chapters I actually included in this book. And what you said, actually, first, I want to answer some of your questions during your presentation. We started writing this book last year, March. And if you see the authors, most of them are very young. Some of them are also very old. And what I tried, actually, what you said, the thing is there only that we actually read about feminist theory and also the rights exist in India and the way to achieve justice, etc. But what I tried actually to incorporate those articles from those people who are working in grassroots level. For example, you heard Aman, who is working as physical education instructor, Diksha, who is working with disabled people, Meera Limaya, who is also professor of our MIT Institute of Liberal Arts. She is 71 years old, having fever, that's why not present today. She wrote on elderly women. She is working 31 years with these elderly women activism in some NGOs. And also we have some young scholars like Ridhima, like Kaustav. Kaustav is student of our ILA, Amity Institute of Liberal Arts. Ridhima is student of Amity Law School. What I tried, like I asked them, go ask your neighborhood, your parents, your friends, prepare questionnaire and survey and interview, and then write what you get the knowledge. And like Soham, Soham is actually MBBS student. So he was like, ma'am, how I can write this paper? But I said, no, you can write, because you can, you are actually like watching what is ongoing in your area. He is from Russia, actually Bengali, but now working at Russia, studying MBBS there. So I actually tried to see the praxis, what you like said. And if you read articles, maybe like we have many scholars worldwide who are very like known personality, they know the theories very well. May somebody will say that these are these articles not like these kind of standard. But what I thought, right? And also we have some very good articles like from some of the people who are not present today, like Anup Shekhar Chakrabarty, who wrote on Mizo people, Amrita Banerjee, who wrote on cross-border trafficking, and many more. So if you read some of the articles, you will get the glance of the reality, what is ongoing in nook and corner of India and other places. So that is our actually effort, and I hope I can send this book to you so that you can read, and you can, because you are a very well-known feminist scholar, I know, and you work in the grassroots level. So I'm really like happy that you are here, and like you are giving blessings to us. I hope I can bring such volumes more. I can encourage people more to write, because the problem is that who write. Like maybe you will find me wrong, but what I saw many times, that we talk about domestic violence, we talk about women's rights, etc. But what I think, the actual people who are facing domestic violence, who are facing injustice, who are not having rights, no rights, they are not going to ask these rights or justice from the authority. That is the problem. So what I tried, like, bring the voices of those into one volume with ISBN number, because I am specially mentioning ISBN number because many said, ma'am, it's like a dream comes true that we are having article in a volume with ISBN number. And I thank Mittal ji, because Mittal publication is one of the best publication houses in India. And when I said that, see, I am going to have this volume with this kind of authors and these kind of articles, he said, okay, yeah, you can go ahead and we welcome your articles. So that's really kindness of Mittal ji. So yes, that's all, ma'am. Thanks a lot for coming. Yeah, Jishma, you can continue.
Thank you. Thank you, Nandini. Again, congratulations, it's great work. And I'm sure all your authors will benefit from it. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Professor Guha Thakurta, ma'am. I thank you for consenting to our request and making time to attend this webinar. Thank you so much. Next, I would like to call upon Sumana Das to share a few views on this webinar.
Yes. Good. Hello, I'm Sumana Das, state-aided college teacher, Joguma Devi College, Department of Sociology, Kolkata, West Bengal. Good evening all. Thanks to Dr. Nandini ma'am and all presenters here. And special thanks to Meghna ma'am. This is the first time I'm listening to you. You are just like amazingly explained how praxis, social justice, and indirectly women empowerment, direct empowerment, like I'm just amazed. Thank you so much. And Nandini ma'am has given me the opportunity to listen you all. And I'm not the writer in this book, but I'm presenting my paper, and I'm presenting my article on how we can give justice to those women who are infertile. That means those women who are suffering with infertility and they are not getting justice in their known world. What we can say, known world. Known world is in our family, in our household, in our domestic life. That means we are not like prioritizing or like we are not getting justice from our known persons, parents, husband, in-laws. These are the three categories that we are very much related with. And these categories come into the primary relationship and primary attachment, that is called domestic level of attachment. My paper is dedicated to those women who are suffering with infertility and they are not getting justice. But be aware, be ensure, be courageous that you can fight. You can go for any medical assistance or treatment, and you can empower yourself by accepting new ways to produce or give birth to a child, like ART or artificial or assisted reproduction. In many ways, like medical treatment, medical assistance you can get. And yes, in all over the world, it is very much accepted and legalized justified system and process to give childbirth. And yes, women can autonomously decide for it. Yes, I want to go for my treatment, quote unquote, infertility treatment, or I can be a mother through artificial reproduction. So my paper is dedicated to those women who are suffering with this problem, and they can get rid of this by ensuring themselves that they have their opportunities, they have support, they can get support from medical assistance, and can challenge and can bring a new world to the next generation and open a new avenue that infertility is not only a women problem. It is statistically it is proven that it is 50% men also suffering with the infertility causes. So women are not only the person that they can stigmatize. So we have to fight for their justice from social world to private world or domestic world. So now I'm going to present my PPT on it. Is that visible to all?
Yes, it's visible.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Yes. Infertility causing women's insecurity in domestic space, a sociological study. This word insecurity is related to justice. That means when we feel insecure, we have to opt for justice and we have to fight for justice. That is why I incorporated this word insecurity and in domestic sphere. The definition of domestic sphere mainly indicate private sphere, whereas home,
we can feel safe and secure and comfortable with our relationship and with our blood relationship and conjugal relationship, and so for us kinship group. But still, infertility cause an insecure world and give insecure world, give injustice within the domestic sphere. Women, around 50% face this problem, and insecurity leads to injustice. Insecurity have numerous form, like relationship crisis, relationship insecurity, kinship insecurity, inferiority complex, domestic shamefulness, household exclusion, ignorance, unimportant membership, isolation, domestic stigma, domestic dysfunctionalism, domestic criticism. Thus, we need to get rid of this, all of this aspect of insecurity by giving them proper and actual justice. No, you need not to fear for your infertility cause or in any health causes, anything you need not to fear. And we have to give justice to you that from medical ground, she or infertile women, she can opt for autonomous decision for assisted reproduction, or she can opt for any other support like surrogacy or like adoption. She can go for that. My objective that to discover infertility causing from domestic insecurity and to analyze infertility as a functional element behind the domestic politics. Here I have kept two important words or keyword I can say. In the first objective, the keyword is insecurity, as I have already mentioned it. In the second objective, the word is domestic politics. So the word politics and justice, we can relate directly, politics and justice, like how politicalized domestic sphere creating barrier for justice. And as a result, women are facing injustice in their known world. So the word politics is not a so-called politics that is going on. It is about injustice or injustice politics. So in the next slide, I have mentioned infertility causing forms of domestic insecurity, like insecurity in their personal life, from their family life, and causing divorce, causing separation, restriction, and no freedom for their like selecting surrogacy, going for surrogacy or going for adoption. Women are not allowed for that. So these are all the way of controlling women, way of dominating women, and not giving proper justice that not giving proper justice to her wishes, we can say. So we have to ensure that a lady can go for anytime. She can go for adoption, she can go for infertility treatment, or she can go for any other type of resources that she can fulfill her parenthood or her motherhood. Infertility causing domestic violence and insecurities, like functional insecurities, like in many families, women are like they lost their major position or prime position in the family, like role of in-law, role of wife, or role of important woman in the family. And she lost her previous function or status or role. And the next section goes to domination and violence, physical violence to mental torture in many ways. So infertility leads to injustice from physical, from mental, from social status. She can get divorced at any time. She can she can forcefully thrown out from her house, bracket in-laws, or from her parental house even. If her parents are not that much supportive, she can thrown out from her house even. So women are not secure in anywhere, in her parental house or in her in-laws house. So that is why justice is very much needed. Therefore, infertility is not a personal issue and it is not within the four walls of the domestic sphere. It is now it is expanded more or less Indian statistics and World Health Organization reported that more or less 35 to 40% women suffer from this issue, and they even suffer from domestic violence for causing infertility. So to give justice to these women, we need to empower them. We need to ensure them. We need to encourage them that she is not at all valueless person. She is not at all excluded from society. She can't be isolated. She is also member of the society, member of her family. And we have to give justice to her from the lens of infertility cause. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sumana ma'am.
Thank you.
Sumana, please stop sharing your screen.
Okay, ma'am.
Next, I would like to call upon. It is my honor to welcome Deepak Havaldar, sir, head of Institute, Amity Institute of Liberal Arts. Sir, please.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I have seen this journey from the beginning. I have seen the efforts of Dr. Nandini Basishka. I have also noticed the participants' efforts, their thoughts. And I think the very, very important thing is that they have done some data analysis and all that. But actually, all those feelings that have come from their heart, that is very important. And I think they are very much concerned on this. And still, it's really, I'm not very happy that still we are talking about all those, the sufferings of women in our country. It should not be happening. Still, we are keep on talking on that. On one side, we see that Sonia Gandhi is there and the Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was there. But on the other hand, we have also seen that many women suffer in our country. Basically, what I think is that financial independence is very much necessary for women. So they will not tolerate all this nonsense. We keep on talking about husband and in-laws and the torture of them. So financial independence is very much necessary, and the women also should be brought up like that. They should not tolerate all this. In foreign countries, we see that the divorce cases are much higher than what we have in India. And we see that our women are very tolerable and they keep their family united and all. All those things are there. But at the same time, what about their suffering? They should not allow all this. In foreign countries, they don't allow all these sufferings. Okay, so on International Women's Day, I think it's really heartbreaking thing that still we keep on talking on that, the sufferings of women, and we should not allow all this kind of thing in the future. In the future means not from tomorrow. I'm very much happy the way Dr. Nandini has done this. I must tell you, she has done it single-handedly. Okay. Before me, Alka Parikh ma'am was there as the head, and that time also and today also, all the efforts that she has made, it's really I praise it. Also, I'm thankful to all the participants, all the authors, and those who have, and some, I have seen also some male authors also. That's really credible. Okay, thank you very much. I have a special guest of honor, Meghna ma'am. I'm really thankful to you for coming to this webinar and for the inauguration of the book. Also, Rani Jha, she's also the guest speaker. And Nair ma'am, the way she handled everything, it was really incredible. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you all the participants, and thank you all the speakers and the guest of honor. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Jishma, just I want to say a few words what Deepak sir said.
Yes, ma'am.
One thing I want to make clear here. First of all, thanking me. Second thing is that you heard Deepak sir saying that nowadays it should not be there because women's are not like women still are facing injustice and they are not getting their desirable rights. And I just want you to share if Deepak sir allows me about Deepak sir. I really salute him. He is I think 10 years younger than my dad. And what I appreciate about him is that he has two daughters, and he is not at all bothered about his daughter's marriage, and all his savings he spent to send well-educated daughters for studying abroad. I really appreciate that thing. Somebody like little thing, maybe you all are thinking like what small thing Nandini is saying, but this is a big thing. You can ask me because I endured all these things because my dad also very educated, well-educated. He was librarian in Calcutta University. But when I qualified GRE, TOEFL and all, and I tried to go for USA for PhD, he said no, because I have one more child and maybe he will try to become engineer or doctor, so I can't spend all my savings, and also I have to think about your marriage. And he is 10 years younger than my dad, but I think this is kind of thing we think still now many parents are, many dads are especially take care of about the marriage of the daughter, not the study or the giving money for their skill development, etc. So I salute sir. I never said this to you personally in office, but I really salute, and I really think this kind of dad we should have in every house.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. And one most important thing I forgot to tell all of you, and wish all of you happy Women's Day to all of you. Thanks a lot. Thank you again, Nair ma'am, Jha ma'am, and Meghna ma'am. Okay, thanks a lot, and happy Women's Day once again.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, now I would like to call upon Jituparna Bhattacharji. She is a student of Cotton University, Guwahati, Assam, and her contribution is towards women rights and justice, myth or reality. I would like to call upon Jituparna Bhattacharji.
Good evening, sir. Beautiful opportunity to express our ideas as a young generation. And I was thankful to ma'am for such a big opportunity. In this paper, I highlight this, how, well, despite having, we have several laws and provisions, how, why women get deprived of women's rights. Uh, patriarchal mindset of our society, and why women they justify their violences because of the various issues in their relationship, because of which they are compelled to justify their violences with them. Basically, they are concerned about the kids and the fear of isolation and the cycle of violence, which I have mentioned in my chapters. So here is basically when the women are always hope for the change, is the if any change in their relationship, so that in that way they justify their violences. And there is also a lack of resources, such as the alternate housing and employment, cash or banks, and there are institutional responses, because most of the counselors only try to save the marriage at all cost instead of taking any steps to prevent some violences. So there are some other reasons also, such as the social barriers, because of which the women not take any bold step to so they are justifying their violences. And there are also in the conclusion, I said that the law is necessary, but as a country, the mindset of the people is changed. There is no real change in our society. As a statement, he says that the effort had been made and focus has been given for the development of quality education and ensuring employment for the youth, and make amendments in the existing legislation, such as the assessment of mental illness need to be incorporated in the PWGP Act 2005 and DPA 1961. So there is, until and unless the mindset of the people is changed and proper implementation of existing laws is takes place, so the concept of the women's justice appears as a myth instead of reality. So here is the requirement of the changing our mindset, and it is only through the imparting education we can change mindset so that women can enjoy their right to the. So basically, after it's my first, sorry, I'm unable to present the people that just came from. So that's why. And then at the last, I want to thank Gandhi again for giving such a beautiful opportunity. And thank you for all. Thank you for your cooperation.
Thank you so much, Jitu Parna. Nandini, ma'am?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yes, shall we conclude the program for today?
Yes, yes.
I'm thoroughly pleased to witness you all in this webinar. We had a great time having you all. I would especially like to extend my thanks to our guest of honor, Professor Dr. Meghna and Dr. Rani Jha, to contribute your valuable opinion. Looking forward to many more such programs engaging more people on a greater level. To conclude, I wish you all a great success in your pursuits. Thank you and have a good evening.